grab your Bible, open it up to Philippians chapter number 4. I've got some sad news for some, good news for others. We only got 2 more weeks in Philippians, all right? So today and next week, and we're going to wrap it up. I hope you've enjoyed journeying through this book verse by verse, and I look forward to wrapping this up next week. But today, we have some pretty sweet verses that Paul is going to share with the church in Philippi, and by God's grace, through the Holy Spirit, the Lord's going to work on us today. Man, it feels like forever since I've preached. I usually don't miss 2 Sundays in a row of preaching. I try not to anyway, but 2 weeks ago, Derek, man, brought the word, did an incredible job. I was able to be here and just worship with my family, and that's always fun to do, to be sitting here and be part of worship. But then last week, I was out again at another youth camp, and Joe preached last week, did an incredible job. Don't forget, as you see those guys, just to tell them thanks, and if the Lord spoke to you through those words, just let them know how the Lord encouraged you through their message. But the truth is, I've been working. I've actually preached almost 25 times since last time I preached here. No kidding. I've done 2 youth camps and then preached at another church. It's been an incredible season. But I say all that because I need you to help me out today, all right? Everybody got it? Say got it. I was about 450 kids last week, students, and there's energy in the room when you've got that much teenager going on. Y'all know what I'm saying? Not only is there energy, there's smell in the room. And so if you've never had youth camp smell slap you across the face, man, you've missed out, all right? So, but it is an amazing time, and we've had an incredible journey. Please don't take offense, students, all right? Y'all know, y'all been, it's bad, isn't it? Go ahead. They know it, they're, mm-hmm, it sure is. So, but I'm glad to be here, glad that people have showered, and we are here to just get in God's word together. Philippians chapter number 4. As Paul begins to really slow down or sign off in this letter, he shares a personal line of thanks because he's grateful for this church. Remember, Paul's in prison, and they have come to encourage him at this time, sent some representatives. They've shown up themselves, and they've sent gifts, and this has really been a joy to him. And so he wants to express his gratitude. And he begins that in Philippians 4 and verse number 10. Let's just look. He says, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you've revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I speak of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am, read these next 3 words with me, church, to be, say it, content. I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. And then shows up this famous verse in all of sports, Philippians 4:13. He says, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. As we begin to wrap up this study through the book of Philippians, and in particular this message is on rejoicing, I think it's fitting that Paul really helps recenter us or refocus us on who it is and what it is and where it is. We are to find our ultimate contentment and joy in. You see, as I open up this passage and I begin in verse number 10, here's what Paul says. He says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that now at length you have revived your concern for me. When I read this, here's the very first thing I see and the first thing I want to talk about this morning, and it's this idea of brotherly concern. I want you to write that down because what Paul expresses in the beginning here is his gratitude and the impact of something known as brotherly concern. Now, Paul was not physically brothers with the church in Philippi, but spiritually he was a brother. There were brothers and sisters in Christ. As a matter of fact, if you're in this room and you are in Jesus and I'm in Jesus, the Bible says we're family, we're brothers and sisters in Christ. So let's just do this. If somebody's sitting around you and it's a dude, just give him a little knuckle, say, what's up, bro? If it's a girl, just say, what's up, sis? Go ahead, give somebody knuckles around you, all right? All right. I know it's youth camp wearing off on me, but the truth is this, is that when we're in Christ, man, we really are brothers and we genuinely are sisters. And there was this concern. Look at what he says. He says, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you've revived your concern for me. Remember, Paul was part of planting and beginning this church in Philippi 10 years ago. 10 years had passed, and 10 years at this time, and distance at this time was different than distance now. I mean, distance now is, it's a big deal, but it's not as big a deal as it was here. Because the truth is, most people in this day and time didn't travel more than 30 miles outside of where they grew up. You'll travel that, some of you, to work every day. And so distance, in our day and time, the world has gotten a lot smaller. But in Paul's day, when he left the church after he started it, it was a big deal because they didn't know if they'd ever see him again. They didn't know if they'd ever be back. As a matter of fact, there's been apparently a pretty good length of time that he hadn't heard anything from them, and thus they hadn't heard anything from him. But now Paul, in jail for preaching the gospel, probably a little bit depressed. I can't imagine every day was youth camp in jail. I can't imagine every day was a mountaintop experience in jail. I imagine there were some dark moments. I imagine there were some lonely times. I would guess that there was a little bit of discouragement. And then one day, Paul gets news. Paul gets news from a church. Paul gets news that some brothers and sisters have been praying for him. They have been thinking about him. They have been lifting him up. They have been concerned about him. And actually now he's got some gifts from these people. And Paul says, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly. I can't help but get the picture of the Hallmark commercials. I didn't realize those things really do make you cry until I had little girls. Now the commercials kind of even get at me, right? But you know, around holidays specifically, they'll start advertising for the cards or whatever it is. And it may be a dad that had been deployed for a long time. And now at Christmas, knocks on the door and shows back up. And all of a sudden, the whole house is just wrecked, right? They're just crying and weeping and hugging. And I'm there crying with them and hugging my, you know, I'm like, what's going on, right? Or maybe it's the kid who's been off at college and apparently they weren't going to come home, and now they surprise mom and dad on Christmas morning right at the beginning of lunch, and everybody gets up and there's the hug fest and the tears are flowing, and I get hungry just thinking about it. But you know these commercials, and this is kind of what I picture here. I get this picture of Paul. He's in a jail cell, and as much as his confidence is in Christ, he has to still be wondering, man, has everybody forgotten about me? I wonder if anybody even knows I'm here. And then there's a knock on the prison door. And they say, Paul, you've got a visitor. Or maybe you've got visitors. And it's some of his brothers from Philippi. And here's what he says, I rejoiced in the Lord, how? Greatly. I just have to believe the tears were flowing, the hugs were happening, and the stories started flying. He said, I rejoiced greatly in the Lord that now at length you revived your concern for me. Now, how did these Philippians end up visiting Paul and bringing these gifts to Paul? Well, I believe it began because he says they revived their what? Their concern. The word concern, if you want to write it down, it means to set one's mind on. So when he says they revived their concern for him, it began by thinking about Paul. As a matter of fact, I wrote this down. All action first begins in the mind and in the heart. That all outward action, all genuine concern displayed first began with concern in the mind and in the heart. It really goes back to even the passage that was shared last week, Philippians 4, 8 and 9. Check this out. Paul says, brothers, whatever's true, whatever's honorable, whatever's just, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever's commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you've learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things. So how did they begin to live these things out? They first had to think about them. So I want to pause and I want to ask you, what brothers or sisters in your life might you need to revive your concern for? Like this. What brothers or sisters in your life who maybe used to be in your life, maybe you used to do ministry together, maybe you used to do life together, maybe you used to be in church together, maybe somewhere along the way they impacted your life, and now time and distance and life has just really separated y'all, and you found yourself thinking about them lately. Have you ever done that? Have you ever been going throughout your week and all of a sudden someone pops into your mind? Anybody? Is that just me? I mean, is that my ADD kicking in? Like, oh, no. But, I mean, it is. And then they don't just come up once. It's like something happens and you think about them again. And then you're thinking about them again. And then you're like, I should probably call them. Or, hey, I should probably shoot them a text. Or, hey, I should probably stop by and see them. Or, hey, you know, I need to take them out for coffee or for lunch. But then life happens again and you don't. Who in your life may God be stirring you up? May God be trying to revive a concern for you? See, Paul was a missionary. Paul was an evangelist. Paul was out planting churches and doing the work of the Lord. And this church that he'd been part of planting 10 years ago, they had revived their concern from them. It reminds me of, I know Baron and them are in there. I saw them a while ago. Where are you at, Baron? There you are, yeah. So there, just, how many, 3 weeks y'all got? Three? 3 weeks, they're going to be heading to Berlin. Now, they're here right now, and many of you have seen them, and you're like, oh, man, it's great to see you again, and y'all have hugged, and y'all have had coffee, and maybe you've had lunch, and in about 3 weeks, we're just going to say, hey, see you, get out of here, right? But man, God bless you, Godspeed, and we're going to pray over them, we're going to send them out. But what happens the next week, and the next week, and the next week, and the next week, and the next month, and the next year? Well, if we're not careful, Baron and Emily and their family will be in Berlin going, I wonder if the Mount has forgotten about us. And so I want to stir us up today. And I want to encourage you today to already begin to be making plans to check in on Baron and Emily and their girls, and to be praying for them and to be reaching out to them. Thank the Lord for technology, right? It's crazy when they were over in, were y'all in Hawaii when we were FaceTiming? Where were y'all when we were FaceTiming? Or Facebook chatting, whatever it was. Where were y'all? You're in Malaysia. Yeah, you weren't in Hawaii. That's fun. Malaysia though, right? It's like, yeah, we're in Malaysia and they're in this one bedroom home and apartment, and the shower and the bed and the table and everything's all in the same room, right? And it was crazy, right? But thank the Lord for technology where we could just reach out and go, hey man, how's it going? What's God doing? And I want to ask you this in all honesty. Who is it that you need to revive your concern for? Who is it that you need to express your brotherly or sisterly appreciation for? Who is it that has impacted your life? Who is it that maybe you told when they were heading off to the mission field, man, we'll be praying for you. We'll be checking up on you. We can't wait to hear from you. And now time and distance has maybe caused that to waver some. I've been somewhat on their shoes. When I traveled full-time for 8 years and you didn't have a home church that you were in all the time. And there's nothing more awesome than to get a text message or a phone call or a gift and where they say, hey man, we're thinking about you. We're praying for you. Man, this is for you. You see, but it begins here. It begins in the mind and in the heart. That's why in Colossians 3, Paul would say it like this, if then you've been raised with Christ, seek the things that are where? That are where? Above. Where Christ is. He's seated at the right hand of God. Look what he says in verse 2. Set your, what church? Your minds on things that are where? That are above. Not on things that are on the earth. Because here's what I know. Your life is a lot like mine. It's fast and furious. Life gets this real quick. We oftentimes lose sight of the eternal. We oftentimes lose sight of kingdom work because daily tasks are just eating at us. And so we've got to set our mind on things that are above. We've got to fix our hearts on things that are above. We've got to put our attentions and our affections on things that are eternal. And here's what I found happens in my life. If I can just stop whenever in my day, and last week I had one of these mornings where it seemed like everything, and it was nothing major really, but every little thing was crashing in at once. And you just feel like, man, I'm done, man. I want to quit, man. I can't handle this. But when we fix our eyes, not on these thousand little things that are crashing, but we take a step back and we're reminded through the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, God is God, not you, as a matter of fact. Go ahead and tell your neighbor that right now. God is God, not you. Go ahead and tell him. Like it allows you to just breathe a little bit and relax a little bit. And so we need to set our minds on things above, not only for our own heart's good, but for the good of others. If we're not careful, we will run through life so fast, so furious, that we will miss being eternally impactful to others. At the end of this service, we're going to pray over one of our young ladies who's about to leave the country, and she's going to be over where she's going for about, I think, about 3 years. Joe's going to share a little bit more of that with us. And we're just going to have the time as a church just to pray for her, to lift her up, just to encourage her. But if we're not careful, we as a church can be so fast, so furious that we forget those that we've sent out. And I'm thankful for our missions team who are putting things in place to make sure we follow up, we care for, we continue to reach out to those who not only have been raised up, but those who are being sent out to make Jesus famous all over this world. So here's what Paul says. Paul says, hey church, I want you to know, man, your gift, your presence, and your presence, man, it revived my heart. It calls me to greatly rejoice in the Lord. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm asking, okay, God, who can I be that for this week? You want something to chew on? Who can I be that for this week? Who can I, and this is crazy to think that God could use anybody in the world to encourage somebody, but he probably wants to use you in somebody's life. Think about that. That someone showed up. Someone showed up with gifts. Someone showed up with a word from the church. Someone showed up and said, Paul, we're here for you. We haven't forgotten. And God used them to greatly rejoice Paul, to just revive this joy in his heart. I don't know about you, but I want to be that for somebody this week. So I'm asking God, who in my life, who in my history, who in my realm of influence could just use not a word from me, but a word from you. And maybe you'd use me to deliver that. Who could I encourage this week? Does anybody come to your mind? Here's what I'd encourage you to do. Write that down. Just write their name down, because you will leave this place and forget about it, I promise. So write it down right now. Who is it in your life, in your realm, in your past, that God may be putting on your heart, that God would use you to breathe a word of encouragement into them, where at the end of this week, they would say something like this. They would say, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly. Why did I rejoice in the Lord greatly? Because you revived your concern for me. Thought you forgot about me, but you didn't. You don't know what an encouragement that was to my soul, Paul says. Who might God do that in through you this week? Write their name down. And then plan some way to encourage them this week. Well, Paul goes on, and he doesn't just share about this brotherly concern and thankfulness that he has for them, but then he talks about this next part, this godly contentment. Go and write that down. Godly contentment. I want everybody to start taking notes because it's about to get interesting, okay? Godly contentment. I think when Paul's writing this letter, he's being very careful. Obviously, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he wanted them to know how incredibly grateful he was and is for their love, their support. But here's what he also wanted to be careful of. He wanted them to make sure that he wasn't writing as some needy beggar. In other words, Paul knew the church in Philippi, like churches everywhere, the church has cynics in it. Y'all know that, right? Skeptics, right? Right. It doesn't matter what you preach, there's always somebody who's giving you one of these. And there's always somebody in the church wondering, hey, what's their real angle? I mean, no matter what song you sing, right? Like at the end of the day, we're going to sing this song, Jesus is Better. Somebody's in here going, better than what? Right? There's always someone like that. And so Paul knows as he's given thanks genuinely from his heart, he knows there are cynical people in the church going, I bet he just wants more. Now look at what he says, because I love this. He says, not that I'm speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am, read it with me, church, to be content. Like if you have your Bible out and a pen, circle that bad boy right there, right? Just underline it. Because this, ladies and gentlemen, is where we need to get. Paul says, I'm not speaking because I'm a needy beggar, because I've learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. I know in any and every circumstance, I have learned, what does he say? The what? The secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I just want to spend some time here, because I really believe these verses hit you no matter what age or stage of life you're in. This is not an American message. Here's the message in our culture, in our day and time. More, 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 more. Oh yeah, and one more, right? Is that just the message I hear? Is that what everybody, right? I mean, think about it. It's in everything, right? There's always a new model of something coming out. I'm always confused how the 2018 models come out in 2017 of cars. I still haven't figured out. What are they doing? They're already making you long for what? What's next, right? Think about it. You got iPhone 7 and you got that. You're like, man, this iPhone 7 is awesome. Do you remember when your iPhone 3 was awesome? Yeah. Did y'all realize there was an original iPhone and it was like, whoo, what is this? It just can't get any better, right? And now you're like, oh, yeah, kid, you can play with that thing in the mud. I don't care, right? But it's amazing how in our culture it's about more. It's about more. It's about what's next. It's about what's bigger. It's about what's better, what's shinier, what, you know. And so, maybe it's not what's bigger anymore. It's about what's smaller, right? So think about this. Our culture has put within us and stirs within us this craving, this fleshly craving for more and more and more and more and more and more. But look at what Paul says. I'm not speaking out of need. I'm not needing more. I've learned in whatever situation to be content. And I love it because Paul's not saying if you have plenty, it's wrong. Paul's not saying if you have abundance, it's wrong. He's not saying if you have little, it's wrong, or if you have been brought low, it's wrong. He's not talking about circumstances. He's not saying if you're rich, man, you're in sin. He's not saying if you're poor, you're in sin. He's saying what I've learned is the secret that whether I have poor or wealthy, much or little, I am at the top of my game or I'm being trampled on by men. I've learned the secret of being content. This is powerful stuff. And if you're like me, I'm like, okay, what's the secret? Well, we're going to look at a few verses. We're going to see. Like Paul writes to Timothy, a young pastor. And he writes these words to him in 1 Timothy chapter 6. He says, now there is great what? Gain in what? In godliness, period? No, check it out. Godliness what? With what? Contentment. So church, we live in an affluent area of the country. I'm not here to preach against, you know, affluence or whatever. I'm not here to preach against or for capitalism, you know, that I'll leave other people mess with that. I just want to share with you what God says. And I believe this is whether you're in an affluent area or you're in the poorest of poor areas. You have to find this godliness with contentment wherever you are, or you will be miserable wherever you are. I know some people who, man, they struggle day by day and they're miserable. I know people who don't even know how much money they have and they're miserable. I know people who struggle every day, and they're the happiest people I've ever met. And yet I know some who have more than I could ever imagine, and they're as content as they can be and happy as they can be. Well, there's something. There's this godliness, and there's this contentment. Look at what he says. Let's get the perspective. And if you're like me, life comes so fast that you often live like this, and you fail to pause and to stop and to look. By the way, this is why you need gatherings like this. Because I don't know about you, but when I gather here, man, my week gets kind of recentered and refocused. This is why you need to be in group with other believers and make that space and time for that. It helps you get the kingdom perspective and stay focused. This is why you need a daily time with the Lord in your own life, because it helps you stay centered on the Lord and refocused. What does he say? He says, there's great gain when you have godliness and contentment coupled together. Verse 7 says, just as a reminder, we brought nothing into this world. You remember? You remember when you were born? No, you don't, all right? So stop shaking your head. Yes, you don't, all right? Yeah, if you do, you're all right. Right, you don't remember it. I don't remember it either. But I remember when my girls were born, and guess what they brought into the world? Nothing. Naked. Needy. That's what they brought. Right? They didn't come with anything, not even an instruction manual. I had 13 nephews. I got girls. I'm like, I don't know what to do, right? This is incredible. Look, they came in naked and they came in needy, and so did you. You brought nothing into the world. I love the perspective of Scripture. And we can't take anything out of the world. Just, again, breathe that in for a minute. Because if your world's anything like my world at times, most of the things that I'm freaked out and flipped out about, they're not going to last anyway. Like, you got a dent in your car this week and almost lost your mind. It's a dent in your car. Take a chill pill. We got body repair people, man. They're awesome. I mean, literally, the things that we flip out about are just unbelievable. It's not that they're not inconvenient. I mean, a water heater busting is not, it's not like, yay, water's everywhere, right? I mean, it's inconvenient, but it's not the end of the world. And if we can step back and realize, hey, we brought nothing into this world and we can't take anything out of this world. Look at verse 8, then he says this. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. That sounds like the American motto, right? Y'all caught my sarcasm, thank you. That's not our motto, right? Our motto is more, bigger, better, faster, right? But look, this is again, if we're going to believe the whole Bible, we've got to preach the whole word. We can't like duck and dodge this, okay? We've got to look at, and at least we've got to wrestle with this in our own hearts. Hey, if we have food and clothing, with these we'll be content. Is that true in your life and my life? I mean, wake up tomorrow, Lord, we got food, still got clothes. Would we be content with that? Again, I don't think Paul is pushing here a poverty gospel. What I believe he's pushing here is to find your contentment in the right spot. And if your heart is right, then the rest, you can take or leave it. That's what he's saying. He's saying, I can have the biggest, baddest house on the block, or I can be needing to sleep over at a friend's house because I don't have a home. But I'm going to find contentment, my worth, my value, my confidence in the Lord. He goes on and he says this, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation. Some of you didn't even know this stuff was in the Bible. Because from as long as you can remember in school, you had the same charts in school I did that showed you why you need an education ultimately and why you need to go to college ultimately and what the benefit of all of that education was. It had nothing to do with education. It had everything to do with dollar bills. I mean, you saw the same charts I did. Those with this degree make this much a year on average. Those with a little bit more education make this much more on average. And those with this much education make this much more. And by the way, if you go to the school with the bigger name, you get more zeros in, well, ultimately your bank account. But that's a whole nother story of all the debt that we have in this country and in our lives. Why? Because we bought the American dream instead of God's reality. Now, I want to let you know, I'm not here casting condemnation on anybody. But can we at least pause and look at what the Word of God says? And where we've misstepped in our life and misspent and our hearts have been led astray, doesn't the gospel deserve us to at least stop and look and say, you know what? Is my life revolving around the desire to be rich? Because look at what he says. Here's the warning. Those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin. Does he say being rich is wrong? No. So please don't hear that. As a matter of fact, in this room, the overwhelming majority of us, we are rich. We are wealthy. We have more than most of the rest of the earth. We have. And we have more than enough. It's not richness that's the problem. It's this desire. Because when that's the desire of your life, you get off track. You fall into temptations. You fall into snare. You'll do anything to get a dollar. Look at verse 10. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. I've heard that verse misquoted so many times. Most people say it like this. Money's the root of all evil. It's not money. Money is not the root of all evil. What is the root of all kinds of evil? The love of money. So I think today we're thinking, man, I want to invest in kingdom, man. I want to live generously, man. I want to bless those who man, maybe I can't go, but I can support those who are going, but I can't. Is it because you can't, because you have this desire to be rich and you have enough, but you want more? Or is it because you want more, and because you want more, you never have enough? He's saying, man, let's recenter, let's refocus. The desire to be rich, you're gonna fall into temptations. The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. It's through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many, many pangs. So I have a question. Just maybe for you and your life and in your family, or maybe you're in college and you're trying to figure out what it is that God wants you to do. I always tell college students this, take the salary away and answer that question. Because if you're like me, I mean, when I was in college, it was like, you know what? Freshman in college, my goal was to be a CPA, and that was all about money. That was the only reason. Well, I could do math. I was good at math, and I loved money. And I had a friend whose dad was a CPA, and he had a nice house and a nice car. And I said, I'm going to do that. That wasn't a God calling on my life. That was Orion calling on his life, right? That was, yes, what did I see? Money, stuff, done. That's it. So I encourage college students, and I'll encourage you high school students, and man, I'll encourage our adults. Look at your life. Is it driven by the love of money? If it is, begin to make those changes now. Ask yourself this question. Would you define your life as one of contentment or of constant pursuit of more? Again, just ask yourself that question. I can't answer that for you. But I think it's worth wrestling with. I think it's worth wrestling with in my life and in your life. Again, please don't walk out to your car today and feel bad, all right? Be like, oh, I shouldn't have this. I'm not doing that. What I want you to do is I want you to honestly look at your heart and look at your life and look at what's driving you. I know some very wealthy people in my life, and they are extravagant givers. I know some people that maybe not be considered that wealthy, and they're crazy givers too. You can't look at what somebody has and say, well, no, you have to look at your heart. How would you define your life as one of contentment, satisfaction, confidence in the Lord, or are you constantly pursuing more? Here's the problem with constantly pursuing more. One of the richest men in his day and time, Rockefeller, was asked the question, how much is enough? And it's reported, here's how he answered. One of the richest men of his day. How much is enough? And here's what was his answer. A little bit more. A little bit more. And if we're all honest, that's where all of our flesh goes. How much? A little bit more. Just a little bit more. And when you get the little bit more, guess how much is enough? A little bit more. When you get that little bit more, guess what you want? A little bit until you find contentment in the Lord. So, didn't see that coming, did we? But it's there. We have to wrestle with this. Paul says, I'm so thankful that you've revived your concern for me, but I want you to know I'm not sitting here begging because I'm content whether you gave me anything or not. I'm content with where I am, with who I am, with whose I am, which then gives him this, write it down, this bold confidence. This bold confidence that Paul has given us that we have plastered on everything and everywhere and used it wrong. So let's just look at it. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. And here it is. I can do all things through him who strengthens me, right? I mean, we've put that on boxing shorts, right? We athletes have tattooed that on their bodies. I mean, we've got it on coffee mugs. It's the verse of conquering and victory, and you're going down. Why? You're going down because I can do all things through Christ. I'm knocking this ball out the park. Why? Because I can do all things through Christ. I'm fixing a slam dunk on you. Just kidding. You're 5'7" white dude. You ain't dunking on nobody. So that's why you know this verse is not true, right? It's not referring to sports, or else I'd be in the NBA dunking on somebody. So check this out. I can do all things through him who strengthens. It is a confidence verse. It's a bold confidence verse. But what's it about? It's about life. Let me tell you this verse is for. This verse is for the moms that stay at home with 4 and 5 and 6 kids. There ain't any way you do that except the Lord. Amen? There in any way you get out of that without being in jail, without the Lord, right? Trust me. You're like, oh, you don't need four or five. Just give me one. It's the same story, right? I mean, this is the truth. I mean, but the reality of it is it's life. That man, we can have plenty and be content. Or you know what? We cannot have much at all and still be content. There is in this verse this beautiful, powerful light. Make it your life verse, but just use it rightly. This isn't about you carrying more trophies home necessarily. This is about you being confident in the Lord even if you go 0-29. This is about you and me finding our strength and our help and our confidence in the Lord no matter what is thrown at us in life, whether we're as healthy as can be or whether we're as weak and as frail as we've ever been. We have confidence that we can do it. We can face everything. Why? Because Christ strengthens us. Our focus is on Him. We're locked in on Jesus. Our boldness and our strength. And man, no matter what life throws at us, we can do it all because Christ is in us. And it reminds me of what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 13:5. Hey, keep your life free from the love of money. And this is in the Bible. We have to wrestle. We have to look at this. Keep your life free from the love of money and be, what's the word? Content with what you're about to get. Is that what it says? What does it say? Be content with what you have. How? Because he said, what? Your stuff will never leave you or forsake you. Your job will never leave you or forsake you. The stock market will never. No. What does he say? Because what? Say it. I will never leave you nor forsake you. This is where the confidence, this is the secret. Realizing it's all about Jesus. Realizing that you can't outgive God. Realizing that things will come and things will go. Stuff will shine and stuff will deteriorate. Realizing that friends will come and friends will go. Jobs will come and jobs will go. Realizing that health will come and health will go. And I can weather it all. Why? Because the Lord will never leave you. He'll never forsake you. So how do we get there? I'm not saying it's easy. But you can start today. How do we get there? Jesus gives us the key. Seek what? Seek first the kingdom of God, His righteousness. And all these things will be added to you. What does Jesus do? He does what He always does. He flips the script. He flips the script. Because don't trust in stuff. Don't trust in things. Don't trust in this world. Flip the script. Don't pursue these things. Pursue me. I'll add all these things to you. Do you realize that God has blessed many with incredible wealth? It's a blessing from God. Do you realize He doesn't bless everyone with that? That's why the prosperity gospel was, all right? So that's a technical term for what Paul calls it, and that is dung, all right? So, you've got to understand. But don't be fooled. Just because someone is prosperous, don't think that's not of the Lord. If we're not careful, we'll flip the script on them and go, oh, you must be doing something wrong. You got more than enough. I mean, Solomon was blessed more than anybody in his day and time. Who blessed Solomon? God did, right? He poured out on him. But what was Solomon pursuing? Wisdom, the Lord. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So I have a question to conclude with that I hope we'll wrestle with this week. One more question for you, and here it is. How can we begin to develop a heart of contentment in Jesus. How, I want you to write it down because I want you to wrestle, teenagers, I want you to wrestle with this week. You have as little of money right now as you'll probably ever have in your life. Yes. You're welcome. Until you go to college, then you'll realize how broke is, all right? So, and all the college people said, amen, all right? Y'all hear any of those kids say amen? Take them to lunch today, all right? So, but you realize how, man, you're going to look back one day and go, oh, I ain't broke. No, I ain't college broke, okay? So the truth is you have as little as you'll ever have in your life right now. So I want you to wrestle with this question. How can you begin to develop a heart of contentment? Because if you're not careful, a love of money, a desire for things in this world, they will drive your decisions, not the Lord, if you're not careful. If you can't find contentment and rest in Him right now, then the rest of your life, starting in college, you will begin to let the dollar drive you and not the God of the dollar drive you. So I want to encourage you students to wrestle with this when you're together and man, think through this. How can I begin to develop a heart of contentment and maybe what are ways that I'm stirring up discontentment in my life? There's lots of ways. I don't have time to tell you everything you need to unsubscribe from, but the truth is all marketing and advertisement is, here's all it is. It is aimed at making you and me discontent with what we have. So here's something real practical. Like, unsubscribe from those magazines you're getting in the mail. That when you get them, it makes you hate what you have. Okay? Y'all can tell I've gotten some of those too, right? I've gotten some of those. You're like, man, this is awesome. Wow, you know? I wish I had those cabinets. Like, really? Cabinets? Like, what was wrong with them yesterday? Now I hate them. Like, I don't understand. If they were gray instead of blue, it'd be more like, what? That makes sense. Anyway, that's a whole nother sermon. But how can we begin to develop this heart of contentment? How? So just think through those things. Because here's what happens. When we find ourselves landing in what we're about to sing, when we find ourselves landing and living in this reality, Jesus is better. Things don't possess us anymore. We possess them. And what happens in the midst of our life is our possessions start to possess us, and that's where it gets flipped. So how can we begin to develop a heart of contentment? I'm just saying from just like personal experience, like last week, well, week 2 weeks ago, July 6th, my wife and I celebrated 21 years together, married. And yeah, thank you. My wife's awesome. Yeah. That's for Heather, not for me. She's had to endure, not me. So, but I can tell you there's been times in our lives where we've made some stupid choices. And if you've been married longer than 5 minutes, you can amen that, all right? So you just made some dumb choices, like financial choices, buying choices. You're just like, why, you know? And now, thank the Lord, I feel like you finally, after you live long enough and God shows you enough and then He gives you these verses right in the middle of your situation, you realize, hey, you know what? We don't really need that. We don't really need it. As a matter of fact, oh, could we get it? Sure. Could we afford it? Yes. Will it choke us? Absolutely. So by God's grace, even just last night, I won't share all the details right now, but even just last night, we're able to make a decision together that I didn't realize really till this morning. You know, the decision was we could get this and make it work, or we could make this choice and get this and have something that's beautiful, I'm finding out, called margin. And if we get this and have margin, it's just like, okay, yeah, this has, oh yeah, it's like everything you want and more, right? And this is like, hey, more than you need anyway. right? And last night we just landed on, hey, let's just go for margin right now. Let's just go for this right now, and let's just put it out. And I'm telling you, it's like all anxiety in the room just melted away. And a peace just came. We're like, oh. And it's like all of a sudden it's like when you know you made the right choice and you knew it was the right choice all along, and then you make the choice, and we're like, wow, that feels awesome. Like, this is what we should have done. And this, wow, we think God can really bless this. Rather than going, hey, yeah, I think they can make this work and we can figure it out, and you know, we can make. I don't want to live like that. Like, and I know that's where some of us live right now. So but where did that begin? It began in the heart. It really is. It's sanctifying. It's sanctifying. Life is sanctifying. And you realize what your heart goes after and longs after and starts to look for. So how can you begin to develop a heart of contentment in Jesus? Because you're going to walk out of these doors, and everything you read and everything you see and everything you hear is going to say, oh no, you don't have enough. Yeah, nope, you need a little more. Hey, that's awesome, but look over here. How can we not chase the things of this world, but rather chase the Lord? I'm going to ask Joe to come up. Brother, you come up here. Speaking of, I believe, someone who's just a great example of this, Joe, yes. But also Lisa Kelly, would you just come up here, please? Lisa's one of our singles in the church, and Joe has known Lisa a lot longer than I have, but as much of a blessing as Joe is in my life, man, Lisa's just a constant encouragement to me. Hey, come on around, come up here with us, Lisa. Joe, did we turn this on? Are we on? Yeah, we should be good. Would you just kind of share what's going on in her life, where she's going, what's happening, stuff like that?